Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning to all of you on this fourth Sunday of Lent. My name is Mary Ellen Lesniak, and I'm one of the members of the preparation team for this week's liturgy. We come together in the hall and at home and are especially excited to gather with our CIA candidates and catechumens and our First Communion candidates. This morning, as we continue our Lenten journey, we will gather in silence with the cross.
Good morning, everyone. We're beginning to fill the space. It's good to see those of you here in person and to be with all of those at home, wherever they are. Hello, those at home. We begin remembering who we are, one family gathered in faith, hope, and love. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace, the peace, and the love of our God be with each of you. Friends, today we continue our journey to Easter. Wherever we are on the journey, let us open our hearts to God's love and mercy.
Kyrie.
Almighty God, who loves us, have mercy on us, forgive us any of our sins, and one day bring us to what our Eucharist reminds us of, the banquet of everlasting life. Amen. And let us pray. O God, whose face we long to see in Christ, you come in search of us, judging not by outward appearance, but gazing into our hearts at the light you have kindled. As once you gave Samuel insight to see David as your shepherd king, as once you led the man born blind to look on Christ and behold your son, so now clear our vision and focus our sight, so that all of us, the elect and baptized, may acknowledge Christ as the light of the world. We ask this through Christ, who gifts our water, light, and life. The Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Let's be seated as we listen to our readings. We are halfway through the season of Lent, and this Sunday traditionally is called Laetare Sunday, a word that means rejoice. As we listen to the readings, we're given the reason of why we rejoice. God gives us this special gift of love in Jesus, who becomes for us our light, a light that guides us through the sin and the darkness that we all have to face in this world.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. God said to Samuel, "Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse of Bethlehem, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." When the children of Jesse came, Samuel looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely God's anointed is now before God." But God said to Samuel, "Do not look upon his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. Our God does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart." Jesse made 7 of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "God has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all your sons here?" Jesse replied, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." Jesse sent and brought David in. Now David was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. God said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed David in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of God came mightily upon David from that day forward. The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. God is my shepherd, so nothing shall I want. I rest in the meadows of faithfulness and love. I walk by the quiet waters of peace. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Gently you raise me and heal my weary soul. You lead me by pathways of righteousness and truth. My spirit will sing the music of your name. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. Though I should wander the valley of death, I fear no evil, for you are at my side. Your rod and your staff, my comfort and my hope. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life. You have set me a banquet of love in the face of hatred, crowning me with love beyond my power to hold. Surely your kindness and mercy follow me all the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of my God forevermore. Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Once you were darkness, but now in God you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to God. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it is said, "Sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." The word of God.
Speak, Lord, I love to listen to your voice. See, Lord, here I am. Speak, Lord, I love to listen to your voice. See, Lord, here I am. My heart is silent, Lord, my soul is still, waiting upon your voice. Tell me your will. Empty, I place myself before your face. Touch me now in the silence of faith. Speak, Lord, I love to listen to your voice. See, Lord, here I am.
Brothers and sisters, and this is a reading from the Holy Gospel now according to John.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. As Jesus walked along, he saw someone who had been blind from birth. The disciples asked Jesus, "Rabbi, wasn't this individual sin that caused the blindness, or that of the parents?"
"Neither," answered Jesus. "It was not because of anyone's sin, not this person nor the parents. Rather, it was to let God's work shine forth in this person. We must do the deeds of the one who sent me while it is still day. For night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world."
With that, Jesus spat on the ground, made mud with his saliva, and smeared the blind man's eyes with the mud. Then Jesus said,
"Go wash in the pool of Siloam." Siloam means sent. So the person went off to wash and came back able to see.
Neighbors and those who had been accustomed to seeing the blind beggar began to ask, "Is this not the one who used to sit and beg?" Some said yes, others said no. The one who had been healed simply looked like the beggar, but the individual in question said, "No, it was me." The people then asked, "How were your eyes opened?" The answer came, "The one they called Jesus made mud and smeared it on my eyes and told me to go to Siloam and wash. When I went and washed, I was able to see." "Where is Jesus?" they asked. The person replied, "I have no idea."
They took the one who had been born blind to the Pharisees. It had been on the Sabbath that Jesus had made the mud paste and opened this one's eyes. The Pharisees asked how the individual could see. They were told, "Jesus put mud on my eyes. I washed it off, and now I can see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This Jesus cannot be from God, because he does not keep the Sabbath." Others argued, "But how could a sinner perform signs like these?" They were sharply divided. Then they addressed the blind person again. "Since it was your eyes he opened, what do you have to say about this Jesus?" "He is a prophet," came the reply.
They did not believe that this one who had been born blind had begun to see until they summoned the parents. "Is this your child?" they asked. "And if so, do you attest that your child was blind at birth? How do you account for the fact that now your child can see?" The parents answered, "We know this is our child, blind from birth. But how our child can see now, or who opened those blind eyes, we have no idea. But do not ask us. Our child is old enough to speak without us." The parents answered this way because they were afraid of the temple authorities, who had already agreed among themselves that anyone who acknowledged Jesus as the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. That was why they said, "Our child is of age and should be asked directly."
So for the second time, they summoned the one who had been born blind and said, "Give God the glory instead. We know that this Jesus is a sinner." "I do not know whether he is a sinner or not," the individual answered.
"All I know is that I was blind and now I see." They persisted. "Just what
did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" "I have told you already, but you would not listen," came the answer. "Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become disciples of Jesus?" They retorted scornfully, "You are the one who is Jesus' disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but we have no idea where this Jesus comes from." The other answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from. Yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if people are devout and obey God's will, God listens to them." It is unheard of that anyone ever gave sight to a person blind from birth. If this one were not from God, he could never have done such a thing. They answered him, "You were born entirely in sin, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out.
Jesus heard that the Pharisees had driven the man out. And when Jesus found the man, Jesus said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" The man answered, "And who is that, sir? Tell me so that I may believe." Jesus said, "You have seen him, and it is the one speaking to you." The man said, "Lord, I believe," and worshiped Jesus. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees near him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." The good news of salvation.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. So has this not been a week of all? Sunshine, warmers, and can't you just feel that spring energy and that sense of hope in the air? And of course, we're getting more and more people vaccinated. There's a good sense of hope on the horizon. And it's good for us to be here together in person. And also to all who are with us virtually, it's good to be able to have this technology be together here today. Now, if we could just work out our sound system, sometimes we'd be in perfect shape. Nonetheless, the Pharisees in this gospel story had sight, but they were really blind. We have sight, we have the sight of faith, and sometimes, however, we may feel temporarily blinded. The liturgy planning group for today's liturgy came up with some suggestions about today's readings, and two of them really hit home with me just recently. So there were two thoughts that they had that struck me. And the question was raised, what is our blindness? What's our blindness? And then there was the idea that was shared in the group, how God's work can shine forth from other people. And I just yesterday had a marvelous experience of both that I want to share with you. This is like a little bit of a personal confession, if you will, because the truth is that sometimes even priests, even people of deep faith, have those moments of temporary blindness, if you will. And so there's been a lot of things happening that have been ruminating in my mind. There's been a lot of people who have had losses and suffering in a variety of different ways. And I was reading a story just the other day. It's a year since the coronavirus started. It was a story about these two sisters who died just 9 days apart. I was preparing to be with the Whitehell family for the funeral of Jeff just yesterday. Next week, that family is going to bury another son. They lost two sons within weeks of each other. And another family that I know shared something about a job loss and some other things. And so I woke up yesterday morning in bed, and the first thing that popped into my head was this phrase that it's a prayer from one of the great saints. Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. And I said, today, if you can, send a sign. I got up and I went about my morning routine. I got my cup of coffee. I went over to my prayer space and I was sitting quietly, just meditating, praying, having my coffee. And my cell phone went off, you know, the little thing that lets you know that you have a text. And I thought, I'm not going to answer it. You know, this is my prayer time. But you know how when that goes off, you just got to know what it's about? It was early in the morning, and I never thought I'd use my cell phone for part of a homily, but I'm going to today because I want to share this with you. Now I just have to find it. I had it all set up. And in the meantime, I've been getting all these texts. Okay. So I'm sitting there with this prayer in my mind. You know, God, help my unbelief today. Show me some sign. And my cell phone goes off, and it was a cousin of mine who is a deeply spiritual woman. And she said, Carl, I have to just show you this picture. The signs from God never cease, okay. So it was this beautiful picture, and I wish I could get it up on the screen, but she had been out walking early in the morning yesterday, and I see the house there. Some of the lights are on in the house, and in the sky behind the house, it's kind of grayish, turning blue, but there were these beautiful pink clouds. You can't really see this, but what are the pink clouds in the shape of? Can you tell us? They're in the shape of a cross. Look at that. I'll show you all later. It was absolutely beautiful. You know, she took that picture from her house in the morning. Yeah, it's beautiful. And so she texted me and said, morning, you can start your day off seeing God's presence. What a great reminder that God is always at your side. Peace, joy, and love for your day. Now, how did she know that I needed that? But she saw that picture, took it, and she sent it to me. And that was my sign. That was my sign. So I said to her, I'm losing my email here. Let me just read this to you real quick. So my response to my cousin was, wow, so beautiful and true. Today, lying in bed as I woke, I said, God, some days I wonder. Don't we all, some days? God, some days I wonder, send a sign. And you sent this, Debbie. Never doubt God is working in you. Thanks. So that was what happened just yesterday morning. And I couldn't help but to remember these questions that were raised at the planning session. What's our blindness? What keeps us sometimes from living in the light and seeing the light? And then the idea that was shared, how God's work shines forth from other people. And that simple thoughtfulness in the picture and the words of faith that she sent to me, that blindness was illuminated. God was very present, and God is always very present. So how does that fit in today with our gospel reading and the readings that we've just heard? Well, believing the man born blind could speak with any authority was not something that the Pharisees in today's story could wrap their minds around or trust. And so they chose not to accept what they were able to witness with their very eyes. They chose to remain blind to see the truth because it was easier to believe that they are the ones who had the perfect vision. But what they failed to realize is that we are all born in darkness. It's called original sin. It's the sin of Adam and Eve in the story of the scriptures, and it's the legacy that they give to us. It's how we understand the darkness and the brokenness of the world and faith. And so in the early Christian era, baptism was often called illumination. In baptism, the believer is illumined by the light of Christ. And it's this light of Christ received in baptism that illuminates our lives as we make our way through this life one day into the next. And yet, as I pointed out, even in my own life, sometimes there are those temporary moments of blindness and darkness. And so it's in this framework today that we hear these readings. We pray for our elect, who will be called forward in just a moment, to have a clearer vision of who Christ is and how the light of Christ can guide them, can guide us as light for the world. The question for us is, do we have the courage? And maybe that's what today's liturgy in Lent is about, reminding us again, do we have the courage to examine our hearts in the light of Christ and then turn away from all that blinds us to God's goodness and truth, despite the ongoing darkness? And so, you see, I was temporarily blinded by some anxiety and some doubts until, through a simple text message and an exchange of faith and a beautiful picture of how God's creation and God is present in that creation around us, reminded me of how the light of God is always with us. It reminded me of this truth. God is always good. He gave us the gift of Jesus, the true source of light for our world, for our minds, our hearts, our souls. We just have to be careful not to temporarily be blinded by the darkness that still exists with the light. And so now I ask the catechumens and candidates Anthony Raniere, Elsa Flores, Mauro Medina, and Gabby Rodriguez to please come forward. And I'm going to ask you, if you're able to, if you would, you're all young enough, please kneel. And if the congregation would please stand. And I ask everyone here and at home to please join us in praying in silence that these elect will be given a spirit of repentance and the true freedom that comes with being a child of God, living in the light. In faith, hope, and love, let us pray for these whom God has chosen, that their lives may remain centered in Christ, and that they may offer convincing witness to the message of eternal life through the good that they do.
That they may find and maintain freedom of mind and heart in faithfulness to the truth of Christ. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That they may prefer the foolishness of the cross to the wisdom of the world and seek happiness in God alone. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the power of the Holy Spirit may fill them with freedom and change their fear into trust. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That they may become spiritual women and men by striving to do what is holy and just. Let us pray.
Lord, our prayer.
That all who suffer for their allegiance to Christ may find strength in God. Let us pray.
Lord, our prayer.
That the people who are hindered from embracing the faith may be granted the freedom to believe the gospel. Let us pray.
Lord, our prayer.
That we who are immersed in the world may remain faithful to the spirit of the gospel. Let us pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the whole world, which the Creator loves so much, may attain spiritual freedom in the church. Let us pray.
Lord, our prayer. We offer this prayer called the prayer of exorcism. God of mercy, you help the man born blind to believe in your Son, and through that faith to reach the light of your kingdom. Free your chosen ones gathered before us from the falsehoods that surround and blind them. Let the truth be the foundation of their lives. May they live in your light forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. And now in a very old and ancient symbol of the church, I'll pause for just a moment over each of your heads quietly as we pray for God's Spirit to enlighten your mind and your I'd ask our candidates to please stand, face the congregation, and if all of you would join me in raising your hands over them in prayer. Lord Jesus, you are the true light that enlightens all people. By the Spirit of truth, free all who struggle under the yoke of evil. Arouse the goodwill of these folks gathered with us here today, whom you have chosen for your sacraments. Grant them to enjoy your light, like the man whose sight you once restored, and inspire them to become fearless witnesses to the faith, for you are the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please join me in a sign of support for our candidates. Thank you, everybody, and you may be seated as we prepare the altar now for our Eucharist.
There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. Sometimes I feel discouraged and think my work's in vain. But then the Holy Spirit revives my soul again. There is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul. If you cannot preach like Peter, if you cannot pray like Paul, you can tell the love of Jesus and say he died for all. And there is a balm in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a balm in Gilead to heal the sin-sick soul.
It is in faith that we pray that the gifts of bread and wine offered now be acceptable to our almighty and loving God. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church. We place before you with joy these offerings, which bring eternal remedies, O Lord, praying that we may both faithfully revere them and present them to you as is fitting for the salvation of all the world through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty, our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, loving God, almighty and eternal through Christ our Lord. By the mystery of the incarnation, he has led the human race that walked in darkness into the radiance of the faith and has brought those born in slavery to ancient sin through the waters of regeneration to make them your adopted children. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth, say this hymn to your glory. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this, eat of it. This is in a similar way, when the supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to the disciples saying, "Take this, all of you, drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new eternal covenant. It will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of our faith, we proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Humbly we pray that partaking now of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Blaise, our Archbishop, and all those who minister in your church everywhere. Remember all our brothers and sisters, those who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with all the saints and those who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and there may praise and glorify you, Jesus Christ. For we believe in faith. It is through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours forever and ever. Amen. Jesus taught his disciples, he taught us this prayer that helps us to continue to live as light, even in the darkness. Our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant us peace this day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin. Protect us from anxiety and despair as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. And we acknowledge each other with some gesture of peace. Peace, 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 peace. All of you folks at home, we extend, to all of you folks at home, we extend this gift of peace. Just a reminder about the communion procedure. We will have two ministers. One will be on each side of the hall. As we come through, there will be someone who will also come before us to spray your hands with the alcohol spray. Please rub that in and then receive the communion. And we pray together in faith. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. May the body of Christ, may the blood of Christ keep us safe for everlasting life. Amen.
Change your hearts this time, your words as it can be. Change your minds this time, your life could make us free. We are the people your call set apart, Lord, this time. Change our hearts, change our hearts. cross the way that leads to your side. Over the mountains and sands of the soul, before us manna, water from stone, light which says we never walk alone, and change our hearts this time. Your word says it can be, change our minds this time. Your life could make us free. We are the people your call set apart, Lord, this time.
O God, who enlighten everyone who comes into this world, illuminate our hearts, we pray, with the splendor of your grace, that we may always ponder what is worthy and pleasing to your majesty, and love you in all sincerity, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated once again. We have another little rite, the rite of enrollment for our first communicants.
On May 2nd, 14 of our community children will join us for the first time at the table of the Lord. 7 of the children were enrolled last year and received their lambs. Today, we formally enroll in our new class and ask their parents to bless the 7 children in the class of 2021. As I call our first communion candidates, will they please come to the front with their parents to be blessed? For those at home, we will also have 3 candidates who will be joining us on screen. So Cameron Daly, Simon Doherty, Grace Smith, Arthur Strom, Finnegan White, Griffin Vestine, and Maeve Gundrum. You can put on your lambs. Dear children, in baptism, Christ called you by name to be friend. Always remember and be faithful to Christ. I invite your parents, who have also been called by Christ, to mark your forehead with the sign of the cross. This is the sign of Christians. Let it remind you how much Christ loves you. We ask that they mark your ears with the sign of the cross. Hear the words of Christ. We mark your eyes with the sign of the cross. See the work of Christ. We mark your lips with the sign of the cross. Speak as Christ would speak. we mark the sign of the cross over your heart. Make your heart the home of Christ. We mark your shoulders with the sign of the cross. Be strong with the strength of Christ. We mark your hands with the sign of the cross. Touch others with the gentleness of Christ. We mark your feet with the sign of the cross. Walk in the way of Christ. Now we call forth the children who were enrolled last year, but whose first communion was postponed due to the pandemic. We ask them to come forward so that they too may receive the blessing from Father Carl. For those of you at home, maybe parents can put their hands on your child's shoulders as Father Carl reads our blessing. Our children at home are Adeline Lesniak, Sarah Gologli, Nate Rosado, John Quinlan, or John's here, John McCormick, and Macy and Malia Sardone.
So, friends, if you'll turn and face the congregation, and community, if you'll stand and once again raise your hands with me over these children who have received or will receive First Communion. Lord Jesus, you are the true light that enlightens all people by the Spirit of truth. Free all who struggle under the yoke of evil. Arouse the good with all these candidates whose you have chosen for your sacraments. We pray now, loving God, we thank you for the gift of the Good Shepherd who invites these children to follow him. May the sheep they wear be a reminder to all of us that we belong to you and that we are precious to you. Bless these children, their parents, and their catechists. As they prepare together, may their faith be strengthened and their joy increased. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. How about a nice hand for all of our first communicants? Now you may return to your place. And friends, before we conclude now with the final blessing, I have just a couple of things. Do you have announcements? Would you like to go first? How long are yours? Oh, my Lord. Okay, go ahead. Here we go.
There we go. Here we go. Good morning, everyone. All right.
You might as well be seated.
Take a seat. Be relaxing. All right. My name's Lisa Simone, and it is our custom, and we've not done it in a long time, to welcome those who we haven't seen in a while and who are joining us for a first time. Welcome. Welcome to all of you. Okay, quick. Every year we ask Family Mass community members to take a name of our First Communion child and to send them a card or a note telling them that we're praying for their journey towards their First Communion. So you could pick up their name, and we're going to be sending out a sign-up through the sign-up genie. You all are experts at that now, probably. So that'll be coming out today or tomorrow. And you're also welcome to send them a note or send them a loaf of bread as a way to share in their journey. All right, Keen Harrison has something up her sleeve, and of course it's more than just her arm. The St. Giles Women Only, please contact her for more details on a special project. Her contact information was in the emails that have gone out. Keen is here in the back if you want to ask her what is she talking about. So please see her after Mass, as well as maybe emailing or contacting her via phone. We have a funeral Mass coming up next Saturday for Chris Whitehell here in the big church across the street at 11 o'clock. And almsgiving today is for Harambee. There's a basket in the back, so if you have a donation to make for that, it will be in the back waiting. Thank you.
Lisa, thank you. It's been a while since I've been able to yank your chain like that, so it feels good. Sorry. But thank you for those announcements. Okay, so just a couple quick things that I want to point out or just make a comment about. The The wearing of those little sheep remind us that we're all called to be good shepherds to one another. And it's a good day for me to just say thank you to someone who has been really a great shepherd to all of us and to our community, especially with all of this restrictions and taking care of safe distancing and cleaning, and that is Alex Ryan. So I do want to say thank you. I'm sure that by the time I leave here and someone else takes over, it might be Alex, who knows, you know. I know that's not what you want to hear, but I am really grateful for all that you have done with all of this, but also with the cleaning and the safety procedures for our community. People feel really good and safe, and this is one of the examples. So thank you for that. I also want to say thank you to Paul for the beautiful music today, very prayerful. But I think there was a voice even more beautiful than yours today, and that was the voice of our little baby Gabby. Can you hold Gabby up? Can you show Gabby? Hold her up. She's the daughter of one of our catechumens. And, I couldn't help but to feel during Mass when she was trying to pray with us. Isn't it wonderful to hear the voice of a child, a baby? Thank you. So it's good to be with you. Hi, Gabby. Okay. And then finally, what is it with all this green over here? Come on. No, I know it's this week is very special, St. Patrick's and St. Joseph. So everybody have a blessed, beautiful St. Patrick's and St. Joseph's Day today. Not today, but during the week. Reasons to be festive. Please stand. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless and strengthen us as we go forward to live in the light and to be the light to one another, especially in those places of darkness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We go in peace to love and serve God by our continued care for each other. Thanks be to God. Have a good weekend, what's left of it.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today. Christ be our light, shine in our heart, shine through the darkness. Christ be our light, shine in your church, gather today.